Hi everybody, Danny here. You know, the Nobel Peace Prize winner Albert Schweitzer gave up a musical career back in the early 1900s. He was kind of world famous back then, kind of like a rock star. And he went back and got his medical degree, and then he and his wife dedicated the next 30, 40 years in service over in Africa, building hospitals and taking care of the sick folks over there. So an interesting story about Albert Schweitzer. But he had a great quote, and I think it's really a good one. He said, I don't know what your destiny will be. He said, but I do know those among you that will be truly happy are those who have sought and learned how to serve. So yesterday at a funeral, me and many of my college friends were given the gift about that as our dear friend Pat eulogized his mom, Mary Ellen McCall. And I videoed that for you. And I recommend all of you to invest the 9 or 10 minutes today and take a listen to it. Pat does a wonderful job in remembering his mom, his family, his brothers, his father, his wife, his own kids. And it's just really good to kind of slow us down. His mom was a wonderful lady. She's in a better place right now. But boy, does she know how to serve. And Pat's pretty funny too, so I think you'll enjoy it. So invest the 9 or 10 minutes. It'll be worth it. Have a great day and be well.
On behalf of my father, brothers, and extended McCall family, I would like to sincerely thank everyone for your outpouring of generosity and prayers over the last 5 months. My father would especially like to thank all of his work colleagues, both on the county and state level, his friends, and his classmates. Your support during this trying time has been greatly appreciated. Mary Ellen McCall, I think my wife Ginny summed it up best when she said, your mother is the only person I ever met that never had a bad day. I've heard my mom described as a dedicated wife, amazing mother, super Grammy, and loyal friend. And although all of the aforementioned are accurate and true, my mom was so much more. She was a disciplinarian. Growing up, like most families, my father worked the traditional 9 to 5 hours. So the task of raising 5 active boys was squarely placed on the shoulders of my mother. She did a fantastic job teaching us to be polite and courteous, respect people and their property, and helped us distinguish good from bad and right from wrong. But she didn't do it all by herself. She had what I would call an assistant. And that assistant never seemed to take a day off. Yes, talking about her wooden spoon. Let me tell you, if we gathered all my mother's broken spoons, we could build one heck of a bonfire. And not to call anyone out, but I do believe my brother Mike led our team in hitting every season. My favorite disciplinary story occurred during my freshman year at Marion High School. It was the first 2 or 3 months of high school, and I remember I was clearly focused on my ability to make my new classmates laugh. In those days, the teachers would write you up if your classroom conduct was deemed inappropriate. A carbon copy of each conduct violation would be mailed to our parents on a periodic basis. Believe me when I tell you, I had no idea the U.S. Mail was involved in this process. So one day I arrived home from school, opened the front door, and directly in front of me, one by one, stretching out the entire hallway, were my conduct violations. And at the end of the path was my mom, with yes, wooden spoon. I think I contributed 3 broken spoons to the bonfire that day. My mother was also a coach and a sports fan. As a mother of 5 boys and a wife of a little league and CYO basketball coach, my mother thoroughly embraced sports. More importantly, she understood the games we played, and in some ways, she was our own little coach. As we stepped out the door for Little League games, it wasn't uncommon for her to provide a little pep talk to each of us. Keep your eye on the ball. Don't swing at any bad pitches. And her favorite, watch your temper. Sorry. CYO basketball games were the same. Watch your passes, be careful with taking offensive charges, and don't look up in the stands, just play the game. As a sports fan of the Call 5, I think my mom still holds the record for most baseball and basketball games attended. I was doing the math the other day and I estimated that my brothers and I played over 400 Little League games and over 500 CYO games. And I'm sure this happened, but I struggle to remember her missing any of our games. Anna's support was not limited to her sons. Over the last 15 years, Grammy McCall can be found cheering her granddaughters, Amanda and Riley, and their Marion High School volleyball teams. This includes travels to the league playoffs, district, and state championships. She also enjoyed cheering on her grandson and godchild, PJ, throughout his high school and AAU basketball career. There was nothing better than Graham seeing her golden boy on the basketball court with his curly locks. Mom spent the last few years at the tennis court, supporting her beloved triplets. Avery, Darby, Madison, as they led Northampton High School to four consecutive winning seasons. For Mom, there was only one thing better than watching McCall on a tennis court, and that was watching three McCalls on the tennis court. And it didn't stop at the high school level. Graham continued to attend the girls' tennis matches as they played at college level over the past two seasons. On a bigger stage, she had a chance to see her Fighting Phillies at Citizens Park, a West Virginia football game, the Big East basketball tournament, and a football weekend at Notre Dame with Dad to celebrate their 50th wedding anniversary. It's ironic that, based on the strong influence that sports has had on our family, one of my mom's favorite sayings in teaching was, "We don't keep score." Which basically meant when we do something for each other, a favor or bend a few dollars, don't document it or keep track. Do the good deed and move on. My mother was also our 24-hour helpline. I remember when my kids were younger and needed to call Graham because they had a question. The conversation would go something like this. "Dad, it's 10 o'clock at night. Do you think it would be okay if I called Graham?" At that time, my kids didn't know what my brothers, my wife, and my mom's friends knew. You could call Graham any time, day or night. As our kids grew older, they, as well as the triplets, were told by my mother, "You can call Grammy anytime before midnight, and if the Phillies are playing on the West Coast, I'll be up later." Believe me when I tell you, we all took advantage of Marianne's helpline, as she was always there to listen and provide advice. Some of the calls that came into the hotline included, "I'm having a bad day, and I knew that if I talked to you, I'd feel better. I forgot I have to bring baked goods to school tomorrow. Could you make me something tonight?" Here's a good one. "I just had three babies crying at me for an hour straight, and I needed someone to talk to." "Did you see the Eagles game today, Graham? What was Andy Reid thinking on that play call?" "I'm making dinner. I have a question, and I need your help. Do you think you can make lasagna for Sunday dinner this week? Graham, I have this pain. What should I take?" And the last one, normally came from PJ. "I see Notre Dame lost today. How's Pop taking it?" The best things about calling my mom's helpline, when the conversation was over, you hung up the phone, your problems were minimized, and you always felt better. My mom was a campaign manager. As a wife of an elected official, my mother was an ultimate first lady. Behind the scenes, she managed my father's hectic schedule. This was especially true in his election years. She juggled daily meals to accommodate his schedule, made sure that he was always on time, and didn't hesitate to host the early morning nightcaps when my brother Mike, my dad, and his loyal followers returned home. And her late night campaign headquarters were not limited to my dad. She gladly played host to my Uncle Tom and Cousin Keith during their 30-plus years in office. And when asked, my mom would gladly hit the campaign trail with my dad. Whether it was a block party, bingo, social gathering, mom was right there, greeting people and gaining their support for my father. It's funny, spanning the 20-plus years of my father's campaigns, I'm not sure my mother ever asked anyone to vote for him. She would simply influence voters by her warm and sincere personality and her ability to be liked by everyone. I know that my father has worked very hard to earn each and every vote in Carbon County, but I think he would be the first to admit that behind the curtain, in the voting booth, The name of the candidate for the Recorder of Deeds should have read Emmett and Mary Overcall. And finally, my mother was a great hostess. Sunday dinner at Grammy's house. There was nothing better. My mom had a tradition of serving dinner every Sunday at 1 o'clock. That is, of course, unless the Eagles were playing at 1, and then dinner would be moved to 12:30. Every week, the menu varied based on the request of her children and her grandchildren. Spaghetti meatballs, lasagna, roast beef, halloumi, oven-baked chicken, the list went on and on. And when dinner was over, there was always homemade desserts to be served. Strawberry shortcake, wine wedding cake, pineapple fluff, and eclair cake. And Sunday dinner was not just limited to the Paul family. Mom never had a problem with any of us inviting a friend or two to join the weekly celebration. In recent years, she had the pleasure of hosting her grandchildren's boyfriends, girlfriends, and college roommates. As I watched this tradition take place week after week, I couldn't help but notice what an amazing hostess my mother was. There was no doubt that we were her guest, and it was her goal to make sure that we all had a fine dining experience. It was kind of like a five-star restaurant on the corner of Abbott Street and Tom. Looking back, I think my mom had us all fooled. It really wasn't Sunday dinner. It was a celebration of the McCall family disguised as Sunday dinner. Lastly, I want to thank God for loaning my mom to all of us the past 76 years. She's now in heaven with her parents, her brother George, and my brother Connor. God bless everyone and be well.